Welcome back to Wisconsin Metal Parts series on progressive stamping dies. Today we're going to talk about a multi-out tool, or a tool that makes more than one part while the die is running. We continue to do this education to share our passion for the tool and die industry. And if you appreciate this information, please like us or subscribe to our channel. Now, a multi-out tool, there's various reasons why somebody may design and desire a tool like this. One might be for higher volumes, and in this case, this is a 4-out tool because it's making 4 parts at one time. Obviously, if you got 4 parts coming out every time the die comes together, this die is producing 4 times the parts of what a normal die would do. So that increased volume could be one of the reasons to do it. Also, it sometimes helps with your material that you can get a better layout and better material usage by doing more than one part in the strip at a time. In this case here, if we were to run this as a single part, we probably wouldn't be able to get away with such a narrow piece. We'd end up using a little bit more material, and at the end of the day, when you do all the calculations, this would be a more efficient way of doing it. Now, another reason could be a part that makes a left and a right hand part, where it would be beneficial to run both of those parts in the same tool. In that case, when you get to the end of the die and the parts are being cut off, we want to make sure that those parts are segregated so you don't end up having to sort all your parts at the end of the die run. So in a higher volume environment, having multiple parts coming out of a tool would be advantageous. Sometimes when you're running higher volume parts, you also may need to build more than one tool to keep up with your volume demands, where having a die that makes 2 or more parts could help reduce the amount of tools that you make. Now, on the flip side of that, if you've got all of your production coming out of one tool and this tool is down for maintenance or repairs, you're no longer able to make parts. So that's a risk reward that you would have to weigh to see what's a right fit for you. Another challenge, as you start adding more parts into a die, you're going to have more cutting and more forming, which is going to raise your tonnage. So you have to make sure that you have a press available that's going to be able to run your multi-out tool as that tonnage increases. Die maintenance is also another area that has to be considered. Now, instead of, this isn't that challenging of a part as far as tolerances go and the type of forming that we're doing, but let's say we had a part that had some very tight tolerances on it, and it's always a challenge when you're running material through a die and you're doing forming, and in a production environment, you're really trying to hold consistency within a certain range. Maybe you have a CPK that is being required on the parts that you're running. So getting one part to run through a die can be challenging enough. Now, in this case, we're talking about 4 parts. So there are times where you may have one of the parts not in tolerance and you start making adjustments to it to try and get that one lane to run back within a tolerance zone. That sometimes could cause problems with one of the other lanes, and all of a sudden you start chasing back and forth. So that really needs to be considered on how complicated your part is. Another thing that you can run into is with your material, as your material gets wider, there sometimes can be different zones within the material of better forming just because of the nature of the material and how it's been rolled and the metallurgy of the material. So that could also cause issues that you're chasing and trying to do too much and have to do a lot of tweaking in order to get your parts to stay within tolerance. So one of the ways that you can put into your design, down on the end of the part here, we could keep these parts separate as they come out of the chute. This particular tool, we didn't need to do that for the customer's needs. They want all the parts to come down and all the parts are mixed up together. In this case, we have no way of knowing which part comes out of which lane. So if there is an issue, we won't be able to easily go back and make adjustments or tweaks. So one method could be to make each of these lanes, as the parts come out, they are all separated so that you can go back and you know exactly which part ran where. Another option would be able to put some kind of mark on the part. Sometimes it could be a letter, sometimes it could be a dot, and you put two dots on lane two, three dots on lane three. That would help the people who are tasked with maintaining this tool as the tool comes back in for maintenance. They'd be able to look at each of those and know exactly what's going on within this die. And they would probably be very thankful of you putting that in at the early design process as the die was built. As we talked about in previous videos on how a progressive die works, we're going to be starting out with pilots so that we can qualify where this part and the strip is all the way through this tool. Right now we're looking at the lower half of this die. So punches would be coming down and punching out these two holes. This is our advancement here, or our progression, which is probably close to about 3 inches. It's going to move forward. Then we're coming down and we're piercing these slots, moving forward another progression. And now we start doing some of this gutting around the outside of the part to be able to cut it free so we can start forming it. So we've got a couple stations here. Now, because we're forming and we're going to be sucking in material on this tool, we're going to be adding in, we've decided to add in these stretch webs because we don't want this strip to move in any direction so that our pilots can continue to qualify this all the way down through the tool. We want these parts to end up right where we need them over their form stations as we go. So here we've got them cut out. Now we start doing our forming. You can see what happens, how that material pulls in. And this is the sacrificial stretch web that we have in here. So we have two of them here and two of them here. And that was done just because of room in the die. So we're doing that across two stations. And then we have an idle station here. There's a couple stations that are missing because this tool can do multiple functions. For this particular part, we're not using this station right now. So another idle station. And again, these are in just for room, to give us room to be able to get our springs and everything else we need that are underneath this tool. Here we're doing some holes that are being pierced in off of the tool. And these particular ones are being done from the bottom. And these are on spring pressure here as this goes down for the forming. It also extrudes this material up. And then we've got a couple more forming stations here where some of these radiuses are being crisped up, brought into tolerance after we do this other punching here. And then as we go down, our next station is going to be to start to trim off this part. And finally, the part gets knocked out of the die and then goes down the chute and back off the press. So that is our finished part as we go through. This particular part is made out of aluminum. So now we're looking at the top half of this die. This is the punch shoe. Here are our pilot punches. As we talked about on previous videos as well, when you punch through material, you need to have a stripper to pull that off of the punch, otherwise it'll stick. That's what this is here. These are your stripper plates. So we have our pilot punches. Here's where our pilot noses start. And this is what locates off the holes to qualify the strip through the die. These are the punches are underneath here that would come through as the die enters into the lower half. Now we move forward into our forming stations. Here was that idle station that we talked about for other parts, other part numbers that run in this tool. Here's where we start putting in the holes and staking these holes in. This was another idle station for other parts. And then we get down to the end and we have our little punches in here for nipping off. And then finally the parts would fall through the bottom half of the die and go out to the shaker trays. We also have our die stops, top and bottom. And remember how we use those when the die comes closed, and that's what times out the die, that puts everything else in sequence on this tool for the forming. It's not so much important for the punching because usually the punches go in a little bit deeper, but when you come to forming, that's where the height of your forms, the height and thickness of your material, and the height of your lower die blocks all have to come together to be able to form and get the tight radiuses and everything else that you're after on this tool. So thanks for joining us today. I hope you learned a little bit more about the pros and cons of a multi-out progressive stamping tool. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. And if you need help on your next project, Wisconsin Metal Parts welcomes challenges, and our people serve with purpose, pride, and passion. Thank you.